Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host. And once again, it's good to be with you. It's a great privilege that EWTN allows me to have to, well, first of all, to meet these fine folk and to hear their stories and then have this great privilege to talk to you about that and to do what I can to help them tell their story. And if I can, to think about what questions you might have for them. And tonight's one of those episodes when I've been able to invite back a former guest. It's been about 3, maybe 4 years since she appeared on the program. And sometimes when you have a guest back, you think, well, now what are we going to talk about? Well, I don't think we have enough time to cover all the things that I'd love to talk about. Our guest is Jennifer Fulwiler. She was a former atheist. She now has conversiondiary.com, which I think has a long history dealing with her own journey. And since she appeared on The Journey Home, she finished her book, Something Other Than God, a wonderful book published by Ignatius Press, and I'm quite sure she's had the privilege of joining Doug Keck on Bookmark about the program, and the book is also available from EWTN's religious catalog. So Jennifer, welcome back.
It's so good to be here, Marcus. What a pleasure.
It is. And as I said, there's so much that's happened since you were on the program.
A lot, yeah.
You know, and as I read your book again recently, I was trying to put this in a framework. And I couldn't remember how soon you had joined the church since you appeared on The Journey Home.
It was my husband and I both entered the church at Easter Vigil 2007.
Okay.
All right. I can't do the math off the top of my head, but it had been a few years when
so
I was
here. So we're pushing
out
about 9, 10 years.
Right.
So it's wonderful. And maybe we'll talk a bit about the book. But when I would guess back, first thing I want you to do is to retell your story. You know, it's mostly there in the book. If you want to hear all the details, make sure you go out and get the book. Retell your story because someone watching didn't see your first episode.
Right. Yeah, I love to tell the story. So I was raised in a happy atheistic home. I was my dad at the time was an atheist. I think he says he's agnostic now. So we're moving the right direction. but he had come to his own conclusions. He'd started asking questions when he was a young person that he didn't get answers to. So he became an atheist. But an interesting thing is he very much raised me. And my mom, we just kind of didn't talk about religion. So when I speak of my faith or lack thereof as a child, I kind of relate it in terms of with my dad, because he's the one who I talk to about these sort of things. He said, I'm raising you not to be an atheist per se. I'm raising you to seek truth and question assumptions. Don't believe something is true just because someone tells you it is. And he said he had the fortitude to say, even if it comes from me, don't believe it unless you have done your own investigation. And, you know, Marcus, I tell my atheist friends, you better be careful raising your kids that way because they'll become Catholic.
Well, let's touch on that before we go, because I'm guessing that there are people watching that remember that era when it became the vogue thing for parents to say, I'm not going to tell my child what to believe. I'm going to let them believe for themselves. And there was almost a whole generation of folk that thought, well, that's the thing we ought to do in America. And it sounds like your dad was a part of that stream of thinking.
You know, I would say that his philosophy was a little bit different, actually, okay. Because I knew a lot of people in that strain of thinking. And typically, the idea that you had behind that type of thinking was, you know, you have your truth and I have my truth. Yeah. And, you know,
so you're saying that comes out of relativism. There real truth.
Right, exactly.
As opposed to your dad.
And I would say that my dad was a more intellectually rigorous person. Yeah. It wasn't what I would see out there in the culture, these ideas like, well, you just do your own thing and, you know, you'll come to whatever conclusions and it doesn't matter. My dad had a sense that truth is out there. And he would say, I think I have found truth and I think it is in an atheist materialist worldview. But what matters more than being an atheist is staying true to this search for objective truth. Mm. And that's really quite a distinction between what I saw. I know what you were talking about, what was in vogue, the sort of, oh, I want my kids to be seekers. And there's kind of an implication there that there's no truth to be found. I mean, what you're going to seek your whole life? I mean, you should be trying to find something if you're seeking.
That comes when the parents, and you know, I can't like none of us can claim what other people think, but it seems to come from parents who themselves were insecure.
Yeah.
And that's part of, even parallel with your journey, you know, the confusion that's out there. And when you're insecure about yourself and you're seeing all these other voices, you just don't know. So if you're insecure, then oh, I got these children. Well, I want them to find truth, but I got to let them find it because I'm not sure I want to admit to my kids I don't know.
Right.
But you know that example in the book when you and your father are out there digging for brachiopods, you're digging for the fossils, and your dad, you find this great specimen, your dad, his excitement of it keys into exactly what you're talking about, his desire for truth. And he would go back into the woods to dig deep because he was searching for that truth.
Right. And that's and I think I was searching for that too. And as my story went on, it's very slowly over many years, I just began to see that I wasn't finding that truth in atheism. I began to see internal inconsistencies in the atheistic worldview. And we very much prided ourselves on having the lock on intellectual honesty. We're the ones who ask questions. We're the ones who ask all the tough questions. And then I would hang out with a group of atheists and say, well, why do you guys say life has meaning? It seems pretty meaningless to me if we're all just a bunch of randomly evolved series of chemical reactions that are doomed to extinction. And in many cases, of course, not everyone, but in a lot of cases, I kind of got hostility in response to asking those questions. And I would think, wait a minute, I thought we were the ones who could ask all the tough questions. And so I began to see some cracks in my atheistic worldview. And I began to see that we didn't have the lock on intellectual honesty that we said we did.
All right. And it's hard to admit that when you find yourself being challenged. Do you tell anybody, or do you keep it to yourself? Do you just keep moving on? Or as you did, you put it way up on a shelf. And for you, right. The issue was death.
Right.
You know, what's out there? And the reality of death, and you didn't want to deal with it for so many years, and you just put that way up
right.
there.
Right. The reality of death particularly, and the implication that my life did not have meaning in light of this. And a lot of atheists would say, I have atheist friends today who would say, I don't know what you're talking about. My life is full of meaning, even though I don't believe in an afterlife or whatever. And I've never understood that. I, you know, Bertrand Russell was the type of atheist. He was my kind of atheist because he talked about how, this atheist materialist worldview is true. But I love his quote. He said, we must build our lives on the scaffolding of unyielding despair if these truths are true, which they are. I was that kind of an atheist. I was kind of a fatalist because I could not get how you can find meaning in any moment if your entire life is going to be multiplied by zero at the moment of your death. And but there are a lot of atheists who would very, very vehemently disagree with me on that.
Yeah, I have actually a favorite author, but he's a fallen away Christian who's now an atheist. And he's in his 80s, and his statement is, listen, I don't know where we came from. Nobody knows. I don't know where we're going. Nobody knows. All I know is that when I die, I'm going to be fertilizer, and I'm going to repay Mother Earth for all the negative I did to her. That's his life.
Man.
I mean, and that's the meaning of his life. And now I'm sad because he's in his 80s.
Yeah.
You know, and you want to grab him and say, wait a second.
There's more. There's more.
Yeah. There's more there. Which I'm sure people were trying to do with you, too.
They were, and it was very ineffective.
What cracked me up about your story was mostly we hear about people who are trying to live the Catholic life or the Christian life, and they're going to high school or college, and they're surrounded by atheists or pagans, and you were the exact opposite.
I was the pagan atheist surrounded by Christians. I couldn't get away from them. We moved around a lot, and we managed to go from one religious part of the country to the next. It was like God had his hand in my life already. So when I got to college, I was very much an atheist, and I was very firm in my beliefs. And now here's a very, very important thing to understand about that time. My atheist convictions were very much based in intellectual ideas. I had thought through this. I very much thought that the atheist materialist worldview was true, objectively. However, there is a thing that I'm sure you see this in the culture, Marcus. I have often said that the new atheism, not the old Bertrand Russell atheism, but the new atheism, is one of the most well-branded phenomena in the world. It is branded, and it is branded as saying atheism is for the intelligentsia. And this became part of my identity. I had some insecurities about my intelligence. And I think this happens a lot when kids reach college. I think it's one of the reasons that so many of our kids fall away at that age. I'd done well in high school. I was kind of considered a smart kid. And then I got to college, and suddenly I was just beaten up by the academics. And I wasn't the really smart one. I was kind of middle of the pack. And so while I was an atheist out of intellectual convictions, suddenly it became a key part of my identity. I wanted that label, just like someone who wears a fancy brand, they might carry a fancy purse that everyone knows costs $1,000 because they want to seem wealthy. Well, I wanted that I'm an atheist sweatshirt, so to speak, to show everyone I'm smart, I'm educated. And that, and in our culture, even among Christians, I've heard Christians say, oh, well, I mean, that my atheist nephew, my atheist son, all these atheists, they're so smart. Atheists are smart. And so, and that's what we have to remember, especially with our young people. They, and I certainly did this, not all of them, but many of them are very attached to this brand. They very much want the identity that comes with atheism. And you see this a lot, especially with kids who are very smart, but maybe their academics, maybe something in their life is making it difficult to prove to people that they are actually smart. Maybe their grades aren't where they should be. They are prime targets for the new atheism.
You know, that's kind of a centuries old strategy of the devil. I mean, it was the same feeling amongst the Gnostics of the early church. They were smarter than everybody yep. else. They had the inside scoop on reality. And, you know, and it's very interesting that the one characteristic that our Lord Jesus calls us to is the simplicity of a child. It's not the arrogance of the intellectual. Yep. And that's the core of our faith. It doesn't mean we're dumb, but it's to be willing to the simplicity of that humility, which yep. is something you learned later. But that's
yeah, yeah. That, that's yeah. That. God taught me that the hard. But yeah, I think it was Chesterton who said, "If I only had one sermon to preach, it would be on pride." There is no faster way to block out God in your life than to make everything about your ego, than to be prideful. And that is very much the state I was in. And so it's a complicated thing that I had good reasons to be atheist, but there was this second part of it that was really fueling that.
Yeah, if you deny God, you're also denying the spiritual battle.
Right.
And you're a pawn to the spiritual battle. So the devil can whisper anything in your ear and you don't know it because you've denied that too.
And there's dangerous.
And there's the pride, there's the intellect, there's I'm smarter than everybody else. And that's like you said, there's the modern atheist, and we just see that all over the place.
Yeah.
They got it all figured out.
Oh yeah. And I did. Oh, I had it all figured out.
All right. Well, let's hear. What happened then?
Okay. So then things really changed. The first sort of step, the first real step away from atheism came when I met my husband. Now, I lived in this world. I'd surrounded myself with atheists. And so it was very easy for me to develop all sorts of ridiculous stereotypes about believers. So I was one of these people who would say, these are all fairy tales. Look at these morons. There are no smart Christians, which honestly, Marcus, it's embarrassing to admit that I thought that. I mean, all of the founders of modern science were believers, most of them Christians. I mean, really embarrassing, but I was mouthing off about that. So I was working at a high-tech company, and I met this very interesting guy who's my husband, Joe, and I was so intrigued by him. He grew up poor, raised very poor. He was raised by a single mother. She was so poor that they often couldn't even run the heat in the winter. Now this was Houston, Texas, so it wasn't that bad, but they were very, very poor. And she had heard about these schools called Yale and Harvard, and she didn't know much about them, but she knew that if you go to a school like that, you won't be poor. And so she told Joe that he had to go to Yale or Harvard. He chose Yale because that's what Snoopy had the Yale sign on the back of his little house. So he graduated from Yale, In 3 years with honors, went to Columbia Law School, Stanford Business School, and studied in the Master's Computer Science program at Stanford while he was there. So I was very impressed by his intelligence. And it was only a little ways into our relationship that I found out that not only was he a theist, but he considered himself a Christian. And I was floored by this. I couldn't imagine. And the thing is, he didn't go to church. He didn't read his Bible. He didn't pray. But I said, you're smart. How could you be a Christian? And he said, and he never talked like this. He's now a CPA too. He's a very linear thinking guy. I'd never heard him speak like this before, but he said, I was baptized in a full dunk Baptist ceremony when I was 13. And he said, when I came up from the water, he said, I encountered something. I encountered someone. And he said, I do not know what I believe about my faith. I don't know what church to go to. I don't know anything about faith. But he said, I will tell you one thing. I will never deny that I encountered a living presence when I came up from the baptismal waters.
Yeah, I remember the way you said it in your book. You said, I know Jesus.
Yeah, right, right.
I know Jesus Christ.
Right.
He said he knew that. He said all the other stuff, you know, he hadn't been formed. He hadn't had the opportunity to be formed at all because of his background. But Christ encountered him, like Paul getting zapped along the road. Yeah, that was a powerful part of your story.
Right. And so I didn't necessarily think he was right. In fact, it sounded like crazy talk to me, all this Jesus stuff he was saying. I mean, Jesus had become a very loaded word for me. I had heard the name of Jesus invoked for people being nasty to me. And you know, elementary school, junior high, it's no matter where you go, there's going to be kind of a pecking order and kids not necessarily being nice to each other. And because I lived in predominantly Christian areas, I had developed a bad taste in my mouth about Christianity and certainly the name of Jesus. I mean, and part of this may have been a spiritual attack, but when people would say the word Jesus, I would think, oh. And so it actually made me uncomfortable to hear this kind of talk from him. And so I certainly didn't think he was right, but I did think he and his friends from Yale and Columbia and all these schools, they showed me that you can be an intelligent, questioning person and be a Christian. And honestly, Marcus, this is so embarrassing, but I didn't know that. And so the next big step came after we got married. We had this completely crazy wedding that I wrote about it in the book. I wore a dark purple dress and we didn't rehearse our own vows. And it was funny. So we had that wedding and we wanted to make a statement, or I wanted to make a statement about the state can't tell us if we're married. So we went down to the Justice of the Peace just a couple days before to get the paperwork done. And then later when we came into the church, we had our ceremony in the church. And my Baptist mother-in-law said, how many times y'all gonna get married? We had three times. Hopefully it'll stick then. But so we had our crazy wedding with me wearing a dark purple dress. The ceremony lasted 7 minutes. I had my Texan relative in his big cowboy hat say, "Where's the bride?" as I walked down the aisle. And then it was about a year after that our first child was born. And it's hard to describe for someone who has grown up around children and around babies what a shock that was for me. I had only held two babies in my life. Joe, my husband, had never held a baby when our son was born. I never had a friend who had a baby in the house growing up. I never had a friend with more than two siblings living at home. In fact, most of my friends only had one or zero siblings in the home. So this connection to this part of the human experience, I could not have been more severed from that. I lived in this sort of adult and kid, big kid world. Babies were not part of my world. So to have this child, I was blown away by this experience. I was truly in shock at what this meant. And it was when I looked down at my son, and he was about 2 weeks old, and I did what my dad had always taught me to do, and I thought through what I believed. That was another thing that I think differentiated him from a lot of the lighter ideas about religion, is he would say, before you assent to an idea, before you say that this is true and I believe this, think through all of its conclusions. Don't be one of these people who says you believe some ideology, but you don't really live it. You do it halfway. And so I was looking at my son, and I had all these wonderful feelings about him, and I looked at him and I said, what is he in a strict atheist materialist worldview? And I said, oh, isn't he a precious little randomly evolved set of chemical reactions that is destined to extinction along with the rest of humanity. And as I looked at that, I thought, I do not believe that this is true. Hmm. And I said, I more than anything else in the world, I know with certainty that the love that I feel for this child, that the love that has come into my family since his birth, it comes from something external to us. And that was the first moment that I was no longer an atheist. And you know what it was, Marcus? It was a break with this silly idea that is rampant in our culture of scientism, this idea that if you cannot measure it, if you cannot prove it in a laboratory, then you cannot know that it's true. And in that moment, I thought, no, we believe that things are true all the time that we can't measure or scientifically observe. And love is one of those things. And I thought, I believe in love as an objective reality that is external to the material world, that is external to the chemical reactions that are the conduits in our brain. And so that was the big break for me, realizing, no, I can accept this as true, even if I cannot prove with the scientific method that it's true.
So, I mean, in a way, the first step then was not just yet that this feeling, this sense of love, an unprovable scientific thing, comes from somewhere else, but that you yourself are more than chemicals.
Right.
I'm more than chemicals.
Right.
I mean, that itself is a world life-shattering reality. Yeah. I am more.
Right.
My thinking is more than synapses shooting off.
Yes.
I am more. There's something here that's reality, and that's something that an atheist has to struggle with. Is the reality of that.
Yes. And you know what I struggled with first, Marcus, is because I had been so steeped in atheism and so anti-belief in anything, and not just Christianity, but belief in anything, is the first thing I thought is, I want to believe this is true. I'm one of those people. Oh my gosh, it's happening to me now. You know that and because that's what I always thought about believers. And I saw this. I went to a very religious university before I transferred to find some atheists. I started out at a very Christian university, and I walked around and I said, "You guys can't take it. You can't take the hard reality of life. So you make up fairy tales to make yourself feel better." And then when I had this moment of realizing that love exists and I believe in it as an objective reality, I thought, I'm becoming one of those people. Like, and that was a tough thing for me to say, do I believe this because I think it's true, or do I believe it because I need to believe it about my son and about myself? And so I, for months even, I struggled with this idea. Is this a real conviction, or is this something I need to believe? And in the meantime, I'd seen this on TV, so I thought I would try saying a prayer. I had never said a prayer. And it's funny, the questions I think you don't think of if you're a lifelong believer, well, how do you engage with the other side? Like, how do you say, like, is this thing on, like a microphone? I mean, how do you start? I didn't know how to start, and so I just said, if anyone or any thing or any things, plural, is out there, I'm open to hearing from you. And then I said amen, because I'd seen it on TV, and you know, the Hallmark channel. And now see, Marcus, I expected at this point, if a personal God existed, that something would happen immediately. I developed this idea, just cultural osmosis from mainstream Christianity, that God's kind of he's an ATM machine. You put in the card and you say what you want and you get it back. And so initially I took this to mean one personal God must not exist, because I called and it went to voicemail, so to speak.
Yeah, the issue that I remember, well, that you talked a little about in your book, in this part of your journey, is this question of, if there's someone out there, why does he show love to this person and not everybody?
Right.
Why is there evil? You know, and those are the atheist questions. You know, okay, if there's a God, then why is there evil? Or why does he, like in the story of Lazarus, why does he save this person and not everybody else? Or in your case, your would have been your uncle, the little boy that died.
Oh, right. Yes, he would have been my uncle.
Yeah. I mean, why didn't God do that?
Right.
And save that person? You know, why? Those are questions that were constant for you throughout your journey.
Yes. So, to jump ahead, once I got to the point that I believed that there could be one personal God. Now, interestingly, this actually came after I discovered the possibility of Jesus Christ. It's you wouldn't expect it to go in that order, but I found some writing by some former atheists, and C.S. Lewis being one of them, that they spoke my language. I think that a lifelong believer has a hard time talking to a lifelong atheist. Their paradigm, their whole way of seeing the world is so different than the way, because I had no concept of sin. There were just things that lifelong believers could not speak to me. And so through what I see now was absolutely the hand of providence, I came across some writing that convinced me that something happened in first century Palestine surrounding the figure of Jesus Christ. You see thousands and thousands, just waves of people converting to this religion, despite the fact that it meant persecution, maybe even death, not just for them, but for their children, for their families. And you see, the Jews who had held to these institutions like animal sacrifice and all of the stuff, despite years and years of persecution, millennia of persecution, you see them abandoning all of these traditions to follow Jesus Christ. And this is the stuff I was reading in these various books. And one of these authors said, you can do all sorts of mental acrobatics to say what happened there. But, maybe the simplest explanation is that these people actually saw Jesus Christ rise from the dead. And I read that, and I think because of that prayer that I had said previously, I was open to grace in a new way. And it just, and God was able to swoop in, and I just had this moment where for the first time in my life, I said, what if it's true? What if God did become a man? It's funny, I didn't understand the crucifixion yet. I didn't understand dying for our sins, but okay, so something happened with the crucifixion, and then there's this resurrection, which I actually didn't know that was what Easter celebrated. I was that isolated from Christianity. I did not know what Easter was. So that powerful what if moment was when I simultaneously became open to the idea of Jesus Christ and to the idea of a personal God.
All right. Why don't we pause there? Because it's time for a break. And, again, we're not going to sell every detail of the story because it's in Something Other Than God, her book, and we covered it on the Early Journey Home program. When we come back, I'm going to ask you, okay, what was the one thing that solidified the whole thing about Jesus Christ and about his church? Okay. And we'll catch that when we come back. See you in a bit. Back to the Journey Home. I'm your host, Marcus Grodi, and our guests are privileged to have Jennifer Fulwiler here. And I don't know, I'm making you condense your story when I'm wondering, we should just tell the whole thing again because you have a very powerful story and the way the Lord touched your life. And it's still amazing when you take a stand back years later and even mature in understanding how God in his merciful grace came down and loved you. I mean, that's what he did. That's what he did.
It only gets more amazing the more I think about it. It's incredible to see how God works and that he could save someone who was back where I was. It's incredible.
In order that you would have thought 10 years ago or that you'd be doing Catholic radio now.
I mean, I know.
The absurdity of that. I mean, it really is. I mean, praise God. But let's go to that question I said I'd ask. If there was one thing, you'd say, what was it in the end that just hit you the side of the head and brought you home?
Okay. It was the hard teachings of the Catholic Church. And let me tell you why. So when I first became interested in this idea of Jesus Christ, there was something, and I know an atheist would hear this and think, oh, this is crazy talk, but I just had a gut feeling there is something to this Jesus person. I read the Bible for the first time in my life. I'd never owned a Bible. I didn't even understand the Old Testament and the New Testament. I'm starting in the Old Testament. I'm in Deuteronomy wondering where the fishermen are. I mean, it was a disastrous experience, me trying to read the Bible on my own. And so I didn't understand what I was reading in the Bible. I was so confused by so much of it. And I was so immersed in this idea that you read the Bible and then you know everything. I actually thought, Marcus, no kidding, that on the last page, there would be a set of instructions. Like, if you find this book compelling, then what you do next is... So I was very confused.
Well, I also love the fact that, again, you're picking up what Christians are doing, so that you also went through that, okay, I'm going to find out the answer in my life, open it, and,
right.
and it was
I
so
did that,
absurd.
Right. I closed my eyes. And it didn't work. It was the funny thing. I get some random thing. So it was just a comedy of errors there, really. But I felt this magnetic pull toward the figure of Jesus Christ. I thought there was something there. It was like a sixth sense. I just sensed that there was something here, and I'd never felt that way about anything before. But here was my question. Who is Jesus Christ? And I was asking this of the culture. This is the internet age. I'm reading blogs. And there would be a group of Christians over here who say, Jesus is just kind of a do whatever you want guy. Just really whatever you want to do is totally fine with him. He just wants you to be happy. Follow your pleasures. Follow your bliss. That's a big thing. Just do whatever you want to do. And it's totally fine. Abortion, euthanasia. I mean, God doesn't love the stuff, but it's okay. You know, if you need to do that sometimes. Now, then there were Christians over here who said, oh, no, this is a God of love, of true love, which involves sacrifice. Our Lord Jesus Christ is someone who he demands that we love God and that we love one another, even upon pain of great personal sacrifice. Well, this Jesus over here and this Jesus, they are not the same Jesus. So I had these questions. Who is Jesus Christ? I want to know him. So I became very interested in the Christian moral code, because C.S. Lewis turned me on to this idea that God is good. When we say when we say something is good, we are saying that it is of God. He is the source of all that is good. Now, so if you define a moral code, saying this is good and this is bad, it's in a way, it's saying this is of God and this is not of God. So this idea that we can all kind of pick and choose our moral code and it doesn't really matter, I thought, no, because again, those are two different Jesuses, the Jesus who says you can do whatever you want and the Jesus that calls you to a higher standard. So very quickly, I saw the need for authority. Well, who has the final say? This Christian says one thing, this says another. Who has the final say? So it was through my blog, oddly enough. I had selected a group of readers. I'd found them in atheist forums. I had handpicked the people there are a bunch of different Christians in there. I handpicked the group of people that could most just demolish atheist arguments. They knew more about history than the atheists. They knew more about science. I mean, these people were amazing. I didn't know it, but I had handpicked all Catholics, to a man. I think 9 out of 10 of the people that I had picked as being able to demolish atheism were Catholic. But I didn't understand this at the time. And so they said, well, think about this, Jen. They said, you're having all these troubles understanding the Christian moral code, getting that answer to who is Jesus Christ. And they said, you know, what if before Jesus ascended to heaven, what if he founded a church and he instilled it with his own authority and promised to be with it with the end of the age? And what if, just like he did with the writers of the Bible, he took imperfect people, people who made mistakes, people who did wrong things, but he used them as tools to convey his perfect truth? And what if that church is still around today and you can encounter Christ through his living church? And I thought, this is it. This is the answer I've been looking for. This makes total sense. And they said, that's the Catholic Church. And I said, oh, no, I couldn't become Catholic. But then when I looked into it, the question I had when I was looking into the church then, because I had nowhere else to go, so I thought I might as well look at it, is I thought, well, how would I know? How would I know if God was with this church in a special way? And when I saw this moral code, And it even included these teachings that I could not have been more opposed to. I considered myself pro-choice. I donated to pro-abortion causes. I never thought that I could come to agree with the Catholic Church on this. When I saw that it was right, and I considered that it has been saying the same thing for 2,000 years as empire after empire fell away around it, won't change what it's teaching, and won't go away, despite the fact that it is usually the most hated institution in any given time and place in history, I said, I see the divine hand at work here. I see something that humans cannot do on their own. So to answer your question, it was when I encountered those hard teachings and realized they're true and they're right. That is when I really encountered Christ, because I finally knew who he was thanks to his church.
So there was a side of your journey which was intellectual, which really stems back from the advice of your father. If you're going to start believing in something, before you do, you could check it out to the end, which is you're talking about there, the moral code, who's this Jesus?
Right.
But think it all the way through. So there's the intellectual side. But as your book also points out, there was also the abounding love and grace of God at work, who was helping you hear, helping you see, but even answering prayer and opening doors, like when you got the house and all the things are being provided and the different things. Talk about, I mean, it's one thing when we think about how do we help somebody come to the faith. We want to give them the arguments, we want to give them the intellect, but we know in the end, it's grace. It's the work of God. Talk about that in your own journey.
Well, one of the things I say in the book, it was a real conversation that my husband Joe and I had, is so God just brought us to this time, right around the time we were converting, where we just had a series of crises happen. And I had to rely on God because I had no other option. God took away all my other options. And I commented to Joe, I said, well, I know we believe God is real, but I didn't know we had to act like he's real. I mean, I really thought, Marcus, even as I was getting closer to the church, that I could make my faith an intellectual thing. That just coming from lifelong atheism, the idea of encountering Christ in a personal way and relying on him, even in the tough moments of my life, even up until right before I entered the church, I thought, that part's not for me. I'm going to be one of the people that reads the books and I tell people all the arguments, but I wasn't opposed to relying on Jesus, but I didn't trust myself to know what he was saying to me. I think, well, how do I know I'm not talking to myself? So that, for me, that was not going to be part of the package. But God, in his love and his wisdom, he sent me one crisis after another, starting with the fact that I was diagnosed with a blood clotting disorder. It makes pregnancy very dangerous for me. I got a deep vein thrombosis, blood clot in a major vein, and then I had to be on medication that is an FDA Category X drug. If you conceive while you're on this drug, it's bad, like 90% chance of very, very bad birth defects. And this was right after I'd said, oh, the church teaching on artificial contraception, it's beautiful, it's wonderful. And then I end up in a situation where all of these doctors are telling me, you've got to go against this. And there was medicine, it cost $1,000 a month. I mean, it was a disaster. And as you see play out in the book, I had to turn the situation over to God because I didn't have another option. And God swooped in and he answered one prayer after another. And to this day in my life, I have never had a more astounding series of answered prayers like that. And the takeaway, as I hope I clarified in the book, is not that you ask God for things and he makes it rain. He gives you whatever you want. But those were signal graces, I think, that he was sending to me to say, you can trust me, even when the chips are down, even when your health is at stake, even when your finances are at stake. You can rely on me in a real way because I am here with you. I am present to you in a real way. And that was a part of my conversion I never expected.
All right. Well, again, your book, Something Other Than God, has all the other details and the website you can go check out. So let's put that aside and ask you a couple other questions, because I mean, there's lots of things you and I could talk about from the things that you've discovered in the church. But given your background, it opens up a door for us to talk about the issues of atheism and the reality of people in our lives that are there. Some of them have chosen to be there. Some of them have found themselves there. They don't know their way other than that. I mean, it seems to me with your father, particularly, it was an issue or a theme of your life. Well, there are people who are atheists that it isn't an issue or a theme, it's just their life.
Right.
It's because of where they were brought up. Help us to understand those people.
I think that...
Help us understand atheists, you know. How can we pray for them? How can we reach them?
I think, honestly, I think I would pray for humility. This is a very unpopular thing to say. I'm going to get heat for saying it. But the truth is, and I saw this in atheist circles over and over again, in the atheist mentality, there is no God. And so man is kind of the highest creature on earth, at least in terms of intelligence. And it unintentionally, a type of pridefulness develops. Now, I don't mean to say that atheists are arrogant or they're always more prideful than Christians. I mean, many of my atheist friends are far more humble than I am today as a Christian. But there is a type of intellectual pride that develops, and it makes it very hard to encounter God. You have those moments where you think, well, I'm not going to try to pray because how stupid would I be? I'm talking to myself. And I think that's why conversions often happen in rock bottom moments. Mm-hmm. I used to think that it was, you hear people finding Christ in prison, finding the Lord in, some sort of bankruptcy or something like that. And so I used to think they were desperate. They're clinging to fairy tales. But what I see now is, I think the reason why conversions often happen in low moments is because we finally just let go of our pride. And that, like when I said that first prayer, I was just at such a low point for different reasons that I thought, okay, this is stupid. This is so embarrassing. I know I'm talking to myself, but I'm going to give it a shot. And it was because I had just been brought low by so many things in my life that I didn't have so much to lose anymore. Because when I was in these circles where everyone was an atheist and everyone knew me as an atheist and that was part of my identity, I would have lost friends and I would have lost a part of my identity, and I would have felt public embarrassment if it had ever gotten around that I was going to church or, heaven forbid, reading the Bible. I mean, I would have, in my circles, that would have been seen as just, you've lost your mind. And so it's a certain type of pride, for lack of a better word, that even good, awesome, well-meaning people, like my atheist friends, it's very important to them to be generous, to give back to the world. They're such good people. But I do think there is atheism is part of their identity in a way that that's very hard to let go of.
So there's one theme that runs throughout the teachings of our Lord Jesus, as well as the other New Testament writers. The New Testament writers along with his apostles, and that's humility. And sometimes the spark that awakens people is that they're humbled by something that happens in their life. And we kind of pray for that. We don't want to get hurt, but we want that pride, that huge barrier. But there was another barrier that I perceived in your story, and that was materialism. And that was a big thing for your husband coming out of his poverty. He wanted to have it all.
Oh, yeah.
He wanted to, remember he said, the first million's the hardest, and he wanted...
Right. First million's the hardest. Right?
That was his theme, his mantra, and that's where he was heading. He had this Jesus thing. I encountered a Jesus, but okay, but...
He also had the wealth. Jaguar.
he wanted wealth, and he felt there's the answer. So from the atheist perspective, it isn't a spiritual answer. But materialism is another answer that's out there for, I mean, how did you guys deal with that in that journey?
God took away all our money. So that was one way we dealt with
materialism. So again, there's to be humble.
Yeah, right. I think what it comes down to, I think part of my quest for career, for status, for income, for money, was in the secular world, there is a great obsession with autonomy. That is what we wanted more than anything. So there's this idea that the meaning of life is to be comfortable, to be happy. And so the way you do that is you get enough autonomy so that if your whim is that you'd like to go sip wine in the south of France, then you have enough money so that you can go do that. And that's and you see this. I think it's hard to fully understand secular culture until you understand that autonomy is the drive, that it is what drives pretty much everything that you see going on in secular culture, this desire to really be your own God. And so what God did, I think, by having us go through this financial crisis, we had to move in with my mom. We went from a downtown loft on the 21st floor overlooking West Austin. It was gorgeous, to living with my mom in the suburbs. And I think what God did through that is he was stripping me of that identity. Like I said, my identity had been so wrapped up in both atheism and as the person who went to the nice parties and drove the nice car. So God had to strip me of that. But it... I also had to let go of the idea that happiness comes by having full control over my life. That might have been one of the biggest realizations of my conversion, that autonomy, having perfect control, actually does not lead you to happiness.
Yeah, well, I remember that, again, part of your story, and you give your attaboy to your husband, Joe, because there was a part there where he came to you and said, we're going to give up the business, and I'm going to take a lesser job for the good of the family.
Yeah.
I mean, that's grace.
That's grace. That was the Lord.
Yeah, that's grace. We got an email here. Let's track this, and maybe we'll come back to some other themes, but let's grab an email while we have one. Christy from Michigan writes, our daughter has gone through Catholic schools and did well. After 3 years of college, though, she has begun telling us that she is an atheist and no longer believes in God. We're looking for ways, besides prayer, of course, to reach her in dialogue, even if we can't convince her to come back to Christianity. Do you have any insights?
I will take my best stab at that. So here is something that I have realized. I talk to so many other converts now that I've shared my story. A lot of people find me. I've been studying atheist conversions and reversions for a long time now. And one of the things that I think is so important, especially when it's a child or a spouse who has fallen away, we care a lot. And I think that the most important thing that we need to do is to remember that conversion is God's work. It is, we can be tools, maybe He can use us, but that conversion is God's work. Second, hard truth, it probably will not be you who is the person who is the conduit of words from the Lord for your atheist loved ones. So you need to kind of accept that and let go of the idea that you will be an instrument of them converting. And here is why I say that. Because it is very easy for us to objectify the people who have fallen away. Again, especially if it's a child. You know what they're missing. You know, not just the eternal life, but just think about, Marcus, how much better your life is with a relationship with Christ. Yeah. And you look at the person you love most in the world, your child, and it can drive you insane thinking like her life is so difficult. It's so much worse than it could be if she had this relationship with the Lord, even in the here and now. And what can happen is we can start to objectify these people. And you're never showing someone the fullness of God's love if you see them as an object. And I think it's a similar mechanism as what you can see even in the dating world. Like if a young man only looks at a woman physically in an objectified way, well, if you only see your son, your daughter, your nephew as the potential convert and not as the funny kid who's great at music and a really smart kid and tells the funniest jokes, if you are fixating on this issue that they must become Catholic, you're objectifying them. You are not enjoying the fullness of who God created them to be. Therefore, you're not really showing them the fullness of God's love. So that is the big thing that, and I felt this as an atheist. There were some youth pastors at my high school, and I think I was the only atheist. I was one of very few. And I was like the white whale with Moby Dick. They all wanted me to go to their youth groups. And I remember one time, there was this wonderful Protestant pastor. I wish I remembered his name. He invited me to his youth group. And he was always so kind to me, even though I wore the black lipstick and the nose ring, and I looked very angry openly. But he invited me to his youth group, and I almost went. And the reason I didn't is because everyone knew I was the atheist. It would have been such a win for his youth group. You know, the other church down the street would have been like, oh, how did you get her to go to yours? And I felt like I would have been objectified, that everyone would have stared at me through every meeting and said, is she converting yet? Is she converting yet? Has she read her Bible yet? And it made me feel so uncomfortable to ponder that prospect. It made me want to push them away. And I think sometimes our kids can feel like that maybe they stop wanting to visit home if they feel like their parents are staring at them like, did she read the Bible? I left it on her bedside table. So we need to be so careful not to objectify.
Yeah, and I affirm everything you said, and I can almost say without any doubt, after all the interviews I've done all these years, all the converts, and you're getting to know more and more and more, that the bottom line was, it wasn't that somebody came around with the most convincing argument. It wasn't just that they found the perfect book or they found the best Journey Home program to make them watch. Right. It was that before any of that started, that somehow in God's mercy, there was grace that touched that person's heart and mind.
Yep.
And so that's what we want to have happen. And the way you do that is by prayer and love. That's all you can do.
Yep.
And we say that flippantly. Oh, yeah, I pray. But we don't.
Right.
We really don't. Mea culpa. Mea culpa. You know, prayer is a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's opening up the channels. It's talking. It's weeping. It's letting it go for this person. And remembering that there's a guardian angel with that person.
Right.
And it's getting all the hosts of heaven involved. Because they're going to rejoice over the salvation of that sinner. They know what's going on.
Right.
That's what the strategy is all about.
Right. And even fasting. I mean, a lot of times we say, well, I'm doing everything. But fasting has always been a powerful way, a powerful, you know, tradition in the history of Christianity.
Okay. Now, wait a second. You're sitting here with your red hair.
Yes.
And
you're
red. Yeah. And you had the... You were gothic.
I was the goth. And see, but Marcus, I was so alternative that I wouldn't even use the word goth because I was too original to even be part of the goths. But I did. I dyed my hair green. I wore the all black clothes and I went to the clubs where everyone dresses outrageously.
Help us understand.
Okay. So you know what's interesting about this? I was gothic for the same reason I'm Catholic. Does that sound crazy?
Oh, now you've even made it. Yeah, okay.
Okay, so here's what I mean by that. As a young person, I had that wonderful sense that my father gave me of seeking truth, asking questions. When I would see an idea out there in the culture, I would say, are you guys actually living this? I mean, you say you believe this, but are we actually doing this? And very quickly, I came to see, I did not like what was going on in the world around me. I think especially as a young woman in this day and age with all the ideas that are out there about what it means to be a woman, what you should be doing with your life as a woman, I felt that there was something very toxic, very bad going on. I was fumbling. I knew there was something else. There was a better way. There was some alternative to this, to mainstream American consumerist culture. And so I wore the black lipstick. I did the nose ring. I actually had a chain at one point that went from my nose ring to my earring. I'm not sure what I was thinking with that one. And I would wear the crazy wigs and all of that. And it was a symbol. It was an outward expression of saying, I see something amiss in our culture, and I do not want to be part of it. And I want it to be clear to anyone who sees me walking down the street in my rural Texas town, if you can imagine. I wore combat boots, and I dressed as a witch to my high school's homecoming dance. It was this big formal thing. I showed up in combat boots dressed as a witch. And the whole thing was about saying, I'm not part of this and don't think I am part of this. And so what's interesting is I really see being Catholic, being Christian, following Jesus Christ, this is the fulfillment of that. It's that sense I had was right, that something's bad, especially for young women, that something dangerous and bad is going on in our culture. And now it's funny, I have that same sentiment. I just don't need the black lipstick anymore. I have the sacraments.
Well, you mentioned in your book that there was a rap singer that you had listened to, but you were drawn to him because... As you compared him to, I think you compared him to C.S. Lewis in a way, you know, that they're both seeing evil in the world.
Yes.
And they're really drawn, they're recognizing the reality, and they're saying there's something wrong. Now, C.S. Lewis found the answer, and we're not sure about the rap singer, whether he ever did, because he was living out in a negative. But at the core of it, you were recognizing that there was a recognition there's something wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's something wrong here. And so, they like the goths, you would say, they recognize there's something wrong, but this is the way that they're trying to live it out.
Yeah.
Well, what we can say, if any of you got children have bought into that, if she can come back, there's hope.
And let me just jump in and say, Marcus, I've always said my two favorite genres of music are rap and Gregorian chant. And it's true, but I didn't know why. And the other day it occurred to me, these are the only two genres of music that regularly discuss spiritual attack. Rappers talk about this all the time, the struggle, the evil. They speak out against evil. And then Gregorian chant, it's a cry against evil. So now it makes sense to me. That's why I love these two genres of music.
Teresa from Ohio writes, I've read your book and love it. I feel like women go through such a spiritual change when they have children. I also feel like there is an increasing movement for women to put off having children. Now, as a Catholic, what kind of an impact do you see this having on our culture?
That is a big one. It's it's interesting, as I have gone through my own journey, I have six children, and one of the things that I was not given full information on as a young woman, just in secular culture, is that children are a blessing. It's great to have children, and that doesn't mean that it's every woman's call to have children early or to get married early, but there's a lot of talk in our culture about giving women full information. We want them to have options. We want them to have choices. But it's false. That's totally false. Because when I was a young woman in these secular feminist type circles, no one ever said, well, you might enjoy the choice of getting married at 22 and having a baby earlier, because that's more years out of your life that you can spend with your children. I had a discussion with a friend the other day who bought into the ideas. She just focused on her career, and she was in her late 30s when she had children by choice. And she said, you know, I know God brings good out of this. I think this is the right plan for our family. But she says, I didn't know how great it was going to be to have kids. And I wish I had more years with them. I wish I'd started earlier, but we're just not given that option.
Yeah. So that's one of the things we can pray about, the young women in our culture today in their 20s and in their 30s that are caught up in these other things, is to be praying that the Lord will give them the spark of grace of motherhood and be drawn to the beauty of children.
And it's an autonomy thing. Again, that's why we are taught to fear motherhood, because as a woman, you can't have full autonomy if you're a mother.
All right, Jennifer, thank you so much.
Thank you, Mark,
for joining us again. And again, I remind the audience of your book, Something Other Than God. It's available on EWTN Catholic. I do pray that Jennifer's journey is an encouragement to you. God bless. We're in this together. See you next week.